what you want to do. Hi world, Cara St. Louis here, and guess what? That's Emily Moyer, and you've been asking for Emily to come back. And please finish these wonderful thoughts that she has about programmable matter that actually has to do with what we eat, what we ingest, particularly things like sugar. You are profoundly intrigued. I said it's resonating with you. So she's going to say some things about that for us today. Hi, Em.
Hi, Cara. Thanks for having me back.
Oh, yeah.
And yeah, so since we last did this, like I have spent a tremendous amount of time thinking about this. I've received like a lot of sort of informational downloads. I've received some clues and hips and tips from friends of, you know, things to look at, to the point where like, sometimes it's overwhelming. So I'm going to do my best to sort of clarify where I'm going with this. And the reason that I'm talking about this before I have it all ironed out is for reasons. I don't think we can wait till we have it all ironed out and figured out perfectly to start talking about this, because like, I actually feel like this is some, if we can figure this out and get a hold on this, that this is something that can be, make massive changes for a lot of people right now. And if we wait for the scientists to approve things, I'm not a scientist, I'm not a nutritional expert. I'm a person who's had a lot of experience with some of these things. And so I'm speaking only from my own experience, my intuition, and the small amount of research I've been able to do. But if we wait for the scientists to come along and tell us this stuff, we'll be waiting forever. And exactly. So we're starting the conversation.
Yes, okay. We are.
Go. Yeah. So, okay. So last time we left off, we were talking about the sugar as programmable matter, and we got into like a lot of the other connections that would have and some of the symbolism and some of the esoteric nature of that. And I've had a lot more thoughts about that. And to start with, not too long after our last talk, let's just say I got a little hint from a friend, and it came in a kind of cryptic way, but so I've been just trying to figure out what she actually meant. And so she basically, the message was that sugar created yeast. And I talked about a little bit of this on an after show we did with a thing just for our patrons with Robert Phoenix a little bit, but there's more to it, and I've kind of extended it, and I really want to hear your thoughts on it.
Okay.
So that sugar created yeast, and I've always understood that sugar feeds yeast, but it also, that was interesting to me that it creates it. If it creates it, then like if sugar is, let's say sugar is programmed, right? Then if yeast is like if that's the programmable matter, and yeast is sort of like what it wants to create in order to, because yeast turns into fungus. And we all understand, maybe people don't know this, but the people who were involved in the creation of the internet and the use of computers as we know it, so you can even find interviews with Steve Jobs talking about this. During the time they were working on this, they were taking a lot of psychedelics. And they were basically modeling the internet after the way mushrooms and vines grow underground, the way they hub. So mushrooms are fungus. And so if we have fungus in the body, there's no reason why it wouldn't be acting the same way as the internet or computers are acting in our body, right? So
right.
If yeast is what's going to be used to create, if sugar creates yeast, yeast creates fungus, and fungus allows holes in the gut lining for parasites to come through, and ultimately parasites, we know, like to eat sugar, and parasites are really the ones that are sort of running on this program, whatever this matter, right? If we have programmable matter, it's going to program something, and parasites in the body, and at this point, we're probably not only talking about natural parasites, if anything is natural anymore, but also nanotech kind of parasites, Morgellons kinds of parasites, which are basically synthetic versions. You know, I'm getting to the point now where I'm starting to wonder, you know, if there is really that much of a difference between the two.
Right.
You know, we all talk all the time about being in the matrix, right? So if we're really in the matrix, if we're living in a computer simulation, wouldn't it follow that like some or a lot of the food we're eating are actually technology or the program, we're ingesting the program to run, if we're the characters, if we're the players in the game, that's how we're taking in our information on how we're supposed to behave, the role we're supposed to play, right? I mean, think about when you were little and you played Pac-Man, right? So you went around eating the little pellets, and the more pellets you ate, you didn't get faster, but the ghosts that were chasing you got faster. So if we can kind of compare the ghosts to the parasites, whether they be the parasites on the inside or the parasitic consciousness outside, maybe there's a relationship between the pellets and the ghost, yeah? So the sugar feeds the parasites inside, and then the ghosts being the parasitic consciousness on the outside that is sort of using the you know, it's like the parasites on the inside are like a receptor or a satellite for the parasites on the outside, right? Like it sort of picks up on the information, you know, the programming or the code. So right. I've spent like a lot of time thinking about that. So I just kind of lost where I was going with that. So this idea of programmable matter, so she said, so the message said sugar creates yeast, which before I'd always thought of it as feeding it. But that's interesting. I mean, if we talk about how we are what we eat, our body, we are what we eat, like what we eat creates what our body is. So that this, you know, this would make sense. If we're eating programmable matter, then that's programming our character, programming our behavior, and control, you know, dealing with the makeup of our body, like at this point. And sometimes, you know, what's going on in people's bodies these days doesn't seem like normal kinds of organic ailments that, that people no. used to have. It seems right. like we have like a level of like the digital virus, a malware viruses, things like that in our bodies, right?
Right.
So, and then the other part of the message, and this is the one that I've kind of, you know, the message said sugar is programmable. It creates yeast. And then it said sugar has windows in it. I thought, oh, that's interesting. And at first I was thinking, okay, you know how you can have, and it could be either way or could be neither of these things. You know, if you're a person who buys a lot of crystals, if you like crystals, some crystals have windows in it. That's like a special yeah. property in the yeah. crystal. If there are any experts on crystals out there, I would love to hear from you guys as to what the significance of a window in a crystal is. Like, what is that? What does that mean? Like, what is special about that? Or what is the function of that? So I thought, okay, that's interesting because sugar is crystalline. Okay, maybe that's what makes it able to be programmable, right? Or able to hold information or carry certain kinds of information. So I thought that was interesting. And then I thought, then the really, like, you know, super Emily conspiratorial part of me thought, wait a second, maybe she means it has Windows in it, like Windows operating system.
You know, I've already written that down.
Yeah.
Okay.
So when I thought about that, I'm like, oh, okay, this might be it, because think about this. Okay, let's see if I can do the whole narrative correctly here.
All right, do it. Talk it.
Okay. What's his name? Bill Gates is the guy out there who's constantly pushing vaccines, right? People go back and watch a show we did earlier this year with Robert Phoenix that was about Bill Gates and Roger Federer. We were talking about the unholy connection between those two and almost how Bill Gates was obsessed with Roger Federer and almost wanting to enter him like a serpent. And
really?
Then of course, days later, Federer turns up with this jacket with a seven-headed serpent on it at a fashion show.
Wow.
And you know, Federer has a organization for feeding children in Africa. I'm sure part of the deal with that is that they get vaccinated. I don't know that for sure. But even though Federer comes off as a super nice guy, and maybe he is, and he's a great tennis player, some of his sponsors and some of the things he's connected to are very disturbing to me. NetJets, obviously we know Nike is weird. We know he's sponsored by Nike and Rolex and NetJets, and then he has this connection with Bill Gates. And we tied in that episode we did with Robert, the fact, oh, that's really interesting, because what Bill Gates wants to do is vaccinate everybody. And if people remember when all of these dead doctors first started turning up in the last couple of years, a lot of them were doctors who were either anti-vaccine or who were specifically working with people who had cancer, autoimmune disease, and autism that they felt was related to something called a nagalase enzyme, right? And it's funny because naga, the serpent from like the, you know, biblical from texts and whatever.
Right.
Okay, there's a nagalase enzyme. And is this an enzyme that is like related to some kind of worm or parasite in the body? Is that why they want to inject it? Okay, and these people, these doctors were doing work with something called GCMAF. GCMAF, I think is what it was. I may have the letters reversed in some way. And this was something that was providing a tremendous amount. It's not available in this country. There are still some countries that it is available in, but some of these holistic doctors were bringing it into the country, treating people and having success. And a lot of them had their practices raided and then ultimately showed up, you know, kind of committed suicide and all that kind of stuff. And so whatever, if this GCMAF is something about the microphages in the body, that I'm not a scientist. I don't completely understand. If people want to go back about a year ago, maybe a little longer, Greg Carlwood on the Higher Side Chats interviewed a guy who's an expert on GCMAF. I can't remember his name, but go back in the archives on Higher Side Chats, and he had an interesting show about that.
Okay.
But okay, so we have this situation with Bill Gates being attached to these, wanting to vaccinate everybody. And if there's a anagelase enzyme in these vaccines, and that's what these holistic doctors were saying, this is the injection of some kind of, I don't know if it's an enzyme that would be created by something that was in the vaccine or if the actual enzyme is in the vaccine. But is this related to a parasite or a worm? Because it's naga. Why is it called nagalase? Right? Like, it's very it's right. interesting to me. I'm yeah. going on the symbolism and whatnot here. Mm-hmm. Bill Gates is also the guy, Microsoft. Bill Gates is Microsoft, right? So would he, I mean, like, just think about this. Like, right. if it, would it be, if there's a parasite being injected into our body, or some kind of worm or some kind of enzyme being injected into our body, is that what needs to be fed information through some kind of programmed matter? And what it makes, I mean, this sounds nuts to me. Could sugar possibly have windows in it? I don't know if this was like a metaphor or she was being serious. I don't know, because I'm not sure. But the whole thing made me think, like, wait a second. Like, are we, like, we think we're on the computers. Are we actually in the computer? Like, are we in the simulation? I mean, go look at the way Philip K. Dick always talked about being in the simulation. At this point, like, you know, we're in something right now that is so odd. Like, when I see all these events that happen, what it seems like to me is that there's some kind of code running in whatever this matrix or simulation is, and whatever has to happen to create, to, like, the code indicates that there will be shooting in Las Vegas, and somehow something about the coding or the people that are programmed or the people who are the players do create whatever is necessary to make that happen. Right, I don't know if it's as simple as, like, there's a FEMA or Homeland Security directing this to happen, or the drill, or whatever. I think that is part of it, but it's because there's a larger code that is requiring the players to snap to that. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And so is this, like, you know, and I'm speaking somewhat metaphorically here. Like, I don't know if this is actually what happened, if this happens, if there's actually windows in sugar. But I thought that was super interesting. You know, just like, think about it. We eat food, we take bites of it, and the way our computer has information, it's also bites.
Yeah, exactly.
Right? And then you have the picture on your computer. If you remember, there's it's a pretty, like, you know, Bill Gates and Steve Jobs did not like each other, right? So, right? So they their systems are very different, and Steve Jobs fought to keep a lot of the things that were Windows related out of his computers for as long as he could. Mm-hmm. And the code on the code left to us on our computer is an apple with a bite taken out of it, yeah. right? And what is the famous way we think of apples? Apples always have a worm in them.
Yeah,
right.
Do.
Okay. Yes. And so, like, in Snow White, when she ate the apple, it was poison. Mm-hmm. In that movie, I can't. My friend was bringing this up to me. That movie with Benedict Cumberbatch. It was a true story about someone. He ate the apple, and that was how he killed himself. And that supposedly is why it was a poison apple he ate. He was like a guy related to something with the Nazis. He did some sort of technological.
Yeah, it was World War II thing. Yeah, I did see that. I can't remember the name.
Okay, so my friend mentioned that she thought that the reason she had heard the reason that the apples on her computer was a reference to that particular character. But I think a lot of these things have multiple references. So we have the apple on our computer. Is that a warning? Is that telling us what it is? You know what I mean? These things all occur to me. And, you know, Bill Gates is really insistent on everybody having a computer and on every, you know, it may even be just that the computers somehow, whatever is sort of given off by, or maybe like sugar, our blood sugar is affected by our interaction with the computer. And there's some kind of thing, there's some kind of symbiosis there, not a good one. But these are the kinds of things that have been, you know, like, I've been playing with these ideas.
Yeah.
And what do you I mean, I have some more stuff, but I want to hear what you have to say so far.
There's lots of things to say. First of all, in terms of seeing this apple everywhere or those sorts of things, my view has always been, since I did my last write-up on the symbol of the crucifixion, is that it's just a big sick joke. It's like this big ha-ha. That, see, this is what we're doing to you, and you don't even know it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I always think of it, because we're dealing with some sick individuals, and we're also dealing with an AI that's amoral because it has no reason to have any, you know?
Yeah.
So yes, those are those things. And as we were going through your course of thinking about this, of course, sugar's got to have windows. Because it is a crystal.
Yeah.
I do think that you're really onto something there and thinking that those pains of the crystal are absolutely programmable, because that's what microchips are, isn't it?
Yeah.
Or at least they were for a long time, radio crystals and all that. Yeah.
Yeah.
And we know we can program those sorts of things.
Yeah.
This thing with food. So some of us, including yourself, are onto this now. We're onto this shit. That they're manipulating us.
Yeah.
Having convinced us that we need to ingest all this stuff. Now, what the actual truth is still what's up for grabs right now.
Yeah.
My opinion, you know, everybody has an opinion about that. Of course, we would have to have an opinion about that. But yes, I think that they are programming us via the things that we ingest in our body. Now, when you were talking about sugar making yeast, what I was thinking about was, okay, we take in what we take in, which is biophotons, and then we manipulate it, we transfer it, we process it, and then I do believe this, Dan Schreiber says this, we actually provide food for the things around us, plants and animals and things like, and the earth. I mean, that comes through us. It's not like we can't tap into it. We fucking make it.
Yeah.
I'm not going to be able to show this because I just said that word. Anyway, yes, I am. Forget it. Okay. So taking that as a paradigm, which I do, and you take sugar as a paradigm, and it's making yeast. And what does yeast do? It makes things rise. It makes things ferment. It makes things.
Yep. Yes.
Fermentation is a big deal. We got to talk about fermentation.
Yes.
Now you're talking about alcohol.
Think about the biblical reference that we got to in the last time. So what if humans started to fall or got stuck in this situation when they bit the fruit there? Think about all the things that are discussed in that area. Jesus or God turned water into wine. Why would you want to do that? Water is perfect. Why would you want to add?
Oh my God! Listen to what you just said.
Right?
Yes.
He turned
this fermenting, and that's why eating fruit.
You eat fruit, ferment. Okay. And the other thing they talk in the Bible about eating unleavened bread. Bread would be so unleavened bread would be bread without yeast. If you're eating bread and drinking wine, you're now donating fermentation, which is yeast. You're now donating, because sugar creates yeast. So you ate the fruit, you created the yeast. That unleavened bread is now, it's a different story. He's talking about, I actually think that the Bible is like a code to what happened to us, what happened to our bodies, and how to, I think that there's information in there that can go either way. Like, it's telling you the what you're doing, if you know how to read it, why this has happened, and how you can sort of care for your body and your DNA. I don't think it has anything to do other than, you know, on a, you know, tangential level with the stories, the way people think it is. And it's about our body. It's about our body.
Yeah, absolutely. You could absolutely be right.
Yeah. And so what? Go ahead.
Okay. And then, well, let me get a couple things out there because it will probably push you right on. You were talking about us being programmed through the things that we eat and actually being in the simulation. A lot of us are talking about the simulation right now. Where do we leave off and where does the simulation begin and all that stuff? Now, you can talk about the movie The Matrix, blah, blah, blah.
Right.
But you know what? It all goes back much further than that. If anybody's ever read A Wrinkle in Time by Madeleine L'Engle, which I always make sure my students hear from me, always, one of the most important books ever written, it talks about one of the children, the youngest child, goes into this situation where everybody's eating the food and they think it's a turkey dinner and it's Thanksgiving and, isn't that great? And it all tastes like sand to him. Because that's what it is. They're eating sand. It's only the hypnosis. It's only the trance that convinces them. And the Matrix picked that up. Matrix picked it up because it's probably true.
Right.
And so what we're putting into our bodies, right?
Yeah.
Anyway, so Wrinkle in Time, that's what it always brings me back to, which is pre-Matrix. And I do also want to say something about Bill Gates, who is one of my
he's so gross.
Favorite people to hate.
A normal person doesn't look like him. A human being doesn't look like that. A human being doesn't look like someone like him or George Soros. These people look like demonic ghouls whose faces are melting off of them. Like, there's something wrong with it.
Well, I recently discovered, and I don't know why we, maybe everybody knows this and I'm just slow, but I just recently discovered that his father had a lot to do with Planned Parenthood with the
infection. Oh, yeah.
I didn't know that. Well, and then his father was all, I was a eugenicist, obviously.
Yeah.
And that really considered most of us to be just weeds. Weeds. We need to get gotten rid of. So this person, this thing, this robot, whatever he is, would have grown up with this, you know, this going through, this training, this entrainment that people are weeds and they just need to be gotten
rid of. Microsoft was IBM, and IBM was the computers used during the by the Nazis to genetically profile people.
Right. I know.
So you know, is this filling people with vaccines and programming the things they eat and programming them through their computers a way to eventually just turn these people off? Like, you don't have to kill them, not shoot them, not take, you know, but kill first, obviously slow kill them through poor health. But also, if we get enough sort of digital matter in our body, can they just turn us off?
There's that. And also they can just sterilize us.
Yeah.
You know, if there are no babies.
Yeah. Well, he has the mosquitoes that have vaccines in them, and he wants to, everything he talks about is always about sterilization and controlling population through vaccines. And if vaccines were really good for you, why would that make the population of the world go down? That doesn't make sense. You know what I mean? Like, it's yeah.
Right, it's not. But you know, the other two things I wanted to mention also, because you talked about Windows, which is usually, you know, the inception of Windows, as you said, it was originally IBM, and then it became Windows. And all of those
Microsoft, yeah.
It's critical. It's absolutely critical to our history. So we could never really remove that from the conversation.
Yeah.
We ought not to do that ever. But, you know, CERN is the one. CERN is where the web came from. You know this.
Yeah.
So you also have to add that in, because CERN is a big part of, like, the eclipse and everything else that we're living through right now.
It's generating frequencies. Both CERN and... All of the, so this is my thoughts, is that the things like CERN, and also even some of the supposedly natural energy and frequency that's coming off of the sun, and I'm also starting to wonder exactly what this sun is. I think there might be another sun inside the Earth that might be the organic
sun. There is. Oh my gosh, I hope I get a chance to talk about that.
But this thing outside, I think the sun and the moon are possibly both technologies, you know what I mean? And the energy coming off of it, and then all of this microwave soup we live in, and particularly this 5G thing, I have a feeling there's a tie-in between the 5G frequency and programmable sugar and the programmed sugar or programmed foods that we eat that is basically going to start. I mean, you're talking about people with really aggressive behavior, right, lately, and just some of this, like, you know, just massive changes in people's, like, personality and energy fields and whatever.
Right.
Just feel like, okay, they don't, like, it's everything they do has always got, like, a couple different levels. Like, they have to have the bad food we eat, the shit they spray in the air, and then the frequencies they bombard at us. And they put those three things to, it's like you can never figure out which one it is, because it isn't one of them causing the problem. It's all three of them working together. And I think the addition of that 5G frequency, if you go back and find, like, I remember the guy's name, but if you go look a few months back on that Kafka Winston World's YouTube channel, and she posts some great stuff about things to do with frequency and electronic harassment and stuff like that. There's a guy talking about why we have to have 5G right now. We can't wait. We can't wait to see if it's okay for people's health. We can't, whatever. We have to turn everything, our entire atmosphere into the Internet of Things right now. We have to do it now. He seems so anxious about it. And why? Why, unless this whole thing is, you know, about constantly being able to program, update, reset us?
It's that division again. We can't ever discount the importance of the eclipse. It's that division. There's a push on each side, and it's a race now. And this 5G stuff is a push on that side. It's a push to get that done and dusted, to get us nailed down. Okay.
Yeah.
And the other thing I want to, before we forget, as we, I will probably move on, is you were talking about fungus. You remember I posted on my Facebook a couple days ago, I've got to get off the dairy again. It's like heroin to me. You know, I can't be addicted to something like this, you know? And then I said, don't talk to me about soy or corn, please, because that's what's coming. I know it's what's coming in the comment section, because they're both poison and I don't want them. Okay, so blah, blah. Anyway, so that started a huge discussion, not about soy. People are pretty hip to that now, but about corn. Well, what is corn? Why is corn bad? Well, corn is a fungus. It's an artificially grown fungus.
Yeah. If you,
no, I don't think
people eat something called huitlacoche, and it is a fungus, like a mushroom that grows on corn. So it's like a, you know, it's like a, it's very tasty and whatever, but it's very good. It's really good. But yes, like it's corn is sugar, and sugar creates yeast, which grows fungus. This is just how it works. Sugar is corn. Sugar is corn, and corn is sugar, basically. I mean, look, we have corn syrup as like the cheapest, ickiest, yuckiest, probably most programmable version of sugar, which is probably why they like that one so much. But I think they're all program. I mean, it may even be almost most of the food. Like I was thinking about that yesterday. I was trying to think about like what is it about the gluten and the dairy and the sugar. Obviously, those things all food breaks down to some level of sugar. You know what I mean? Like that's a natural thing that occurs. It breaks off into, you know, glucose, which helps feed the body. And then the rest, you know, sucrose or is it fructose? I get confused sometimes. And that is like junk. And it's the junk that I'm concerned about. The part that doesn't feed your muscles. That's like when people say we have junk DNA. Well, isn't the junk part that they're calling junk DNA just the part that's been shut off or been programmed to be dysfunctional? So is that part of the sugar that, but even when it comes, like when you eat, somebody left a comment and I appreciate it about how even if you eat celery, there's some sugar in it. Of course, the body takes the good sugar, dumps the rest. But do they know that? What's in that junk sugar? I mean, I think in celery, most of it is the good stuff that goes to, you know, feeding your muscles, and you need to have some sugar to be able to exercise and be able to function properly physically. But that isn't sugar that doesn't mean a sweet food or sugar that's added, or even fruit for that matter. You know, all food breaks down to some level of sugar, but gluten, dairy, obviously sugar, these things break down to, like, you know, mostly that, to a lot of that, like, you know, even if they're not sweet and whatnot. And what, and those are the foods that, like, that people are most addicted to. You don't hear too many people going around talking about how addicted they are to broccoli, you know, or how addicted they, like, there's a lot of people that like meat, but it's a different thing than, you know, like, it's not like you're just like, can't stay out. You keep going back to the refrigerator for more meat. People want to eat meat for their main deal and they're pretty much done with it and move on. Right. Or even with fat, same thing. Like they have some fat and they move on. But when you have something that's like sugary, or how good bread or
another piece of cake,
it feels good on the teeth. It feels, there's something that feels good about that. Mm-hmm. And these are the things that people are most addicted to. I'm just, I'm 4 weeks into like a very, I eat a particular diet all the time, but like I always eat a modified version of what I'm doing right now. But right now I'm on like a very strict program for 90 days, and I'm about 27 or 28 days into it. I have not had any gluten, dairy, sugar, soy, anything artificial. I haven't had any kinds of nuts that have parasites. Like I eat almonds or macadamia nuts, but peanuts and things like that have parasites in them. I haven't had it. There's even more restrictions within that. And I feel really good. And my mind feels really, really clear. And I'm also my body's responding to it in like a way where it's like kind of incredible for someone who's 42. You know what I mean? Like my body is starting to look like it did when I was, you know, 18 or whatever again, which is interesting. Yeah.
But that's so interesting, Emily, because I would have thought you were, I swear to God, I would have thought you were in your 20s. I was like, Mandy, you hooked up with this kid. What the heck? You know?
Yeah.
No, I really did.
Yeah. No, I'm 42.
Yeah.
And so it's interesting, but I also have to admit that like during this period of time, I keep having this feeling that like, and it isn't just a feeling about me, it's a feeling about all of us, like all of our sort of collective, our group, the ones that are, you know who they are and I know who they are, that we are eerily close to something. We're eerily close to something. And some of this, and it's funny, when Randy posted that Editorfa at link yesterday, this is actually like, I have so little free time, but I have to make time to start to read this, because something about that tells me that like there's a piece we're looking for. We were talking about this in a show we just recorded with Rock Astaldo the other day. Like I really feel like there's another world, and maybe it's the world that we're actually from, okay, and it's a world within a world. And the way you get there is not like you don't just like drive there or whatever. It's you have to align yourself with the frequency of that world, and then you sort of can cross through. You can sort of cross through to that. And feel like it has to do with the way your body is vibrating and and what you eat having to do with it. And what if, and this is what I really want to get your take on, because you know so much about the Fae. Okay, so what if, let's just say for the sake of discussion, I don't know, you know, I'm not even 100% familiar with all of your research on the Fae, but I do a lot of intuitive hitting on what people are on certain things.
Yeah.
So what if we are the Fae, right? But like, what if we, like, and what if the Fae or something like that is the sort of civilization that lives in this inner world? And we, for some reason, decided we wanted to come out or come down or come in and experience, have an experience on the surface of the earth. And we got here and we ate the fruit in the garden and we got stuck.
Yeah.
And we got stuck. Yeah. And the Fae aren't something different than us. It's our consciousness that is still there. We're still connected to it. Our friend Cliff High would call it our knowing mind. Okay.
Right.
Like our knowing mind, that we were reduced from a level of knowing to thinking. And while thinking is great, and I suggest everybody do a lot more of it, it's a different than being in a state of knowing, right?
Right.
Okay.
Right.
And you know, this whole, I mean, if we, let's just say that like we came out to the surface of the earth, or we, you know, or we lived not in a physical body, but we decided that we wanted to experience what that would be like. We were, you know, maybe we even created this simulation and didn't realize that there was, you know, maybe we created it with technology and didn't realize that the technology in some ways had a certain kind of mind of its own, not a creative mind, but like a trapping parasitic mind. And once it gets the players to enter the game, it's going to feed off of them for a long time, right? So we enter the game, we ate the apple, we got the parasite, we drank the wine, the parasite likes the fermentation, the bread, all the kind of stuff in there, and that's sort of how we're stuck. And that, you know, the way that we basically regain our ability to exit or to cross back and forth unimpeded is by bringing our bodies back to the proper, sometimes I feel like these words vibration and frequency are overused, but they're,
no, I don't, but frequency is what you want right now, I think.
Yeah, to the, yeah. Right? Like we have become very dense, we have become very and very programmed, you know, yeah. What I mean? And if we remove, you know, like, and I think there are certain things, like obviously we can recognize a difference between like foods that we're eating that are full of sugar and fruit, let's say, right? My friend Danny brought something interesting up to me, and she said that she felt like fruit and humans eating fruit is an evolutionary adaptation, right? So like once we were here, like the reason people like fruit, and what, like once we were, if you, like, you almost need to have some of that to exist the way we exist on the outside here. You know what I mean? And so I don't know at this point if, like, you know, we had a conversation last time about the elimination of all fruit. Like, I think for some people that would work. Maybe for those of us, you know, maybe some people out here are originals that were, you know, like we were some of the first people here and we come from that other place. And the people that are the souls that have come along since then are a little bit different. And for them, they need that. I, you know, for some of us, maybe we don't need the fruit. Maybe we can really restrict our bodies from in taking those things and sort of realign ourselves with where we're actually from. I don't know. These are just the things that I think about.
No, so, I think this is a really good train of thought. It is. I don't need fruit. I don't want it. I'm not attracted to it at all. We talked about that fruit. My body reacts to fruit or candy in exactly the same way. In fact, my body processes sugar better than it processes a banana. Right. Okay, it does.
Yeah. Well, so bananas have a lot of sugar. Bananas, you can eat other things to get potassium. Bananas have some of the highest glycemic index of any food, particularly bananas that are very ripe. If you're going to eat a banana for potassium, eat it before it's ripe when it hasn't developed all of its sugars yet. Yeah.
So the only thing, two things I want to say, first of all, and they're two sort of separate things.
Yeah.
Crystalline sugar is, it really is, I was going to say false, but let's just say contraindicated, shall we? It's crystal. Mm-hmm. It's very yin, which is really, it's really odd. It manipulates the yin parts of your body. In my experience, in my view, when I have too much yin going on, I always get the hiccups. And I put a tablespoon of salt under my tongue and they go away. Huh. Because salt is very yang. Salt is also, although a lot of doctors, cancer doctors alternative, let's say alternative doctors, mm-hmm. cancer doctors, will say that table salt is also poison, and it is iodized table salt. But what you get out of the ground, whether it's Himalayan mm-hmm. salt or whatever, also is crystalline. It's also crystalline. So you have two crystalline substances, salt and sugar, and you have yang and you have yin. Yeah?
Yeah.
So I think it's worth, I don't have a lot to say about that right this second.
No, I think you're thinking
about those two things.
Yeah, I think you're on
the other. Yeah?
I have the same thoughts and feelings. Like for me, I feel like salt is good and sugar is bad.
Exactly.
I said that about the yin. Like yeah. I once went, and this was like back in my really unhealthy, really destructive days. The first time I ever went for acupuncture, mm-hmm. this Asian woman, and I did not like her. She was mean to me, but it was the best acupuncture session I ever had. Okay. Right. You know what? But like, she saw me. She saw what a fucking disgusting mess I was. And she's like, you're a fucking mess. And now I
will say that to you. Yes.
At the time, you know, and also that I was in a lot of ways, the creator of the mess that I was. And she like, just something about her energy was like immediately showing me myself. And I didn't like it at that time. Now I can deal with it.
Right. Right.
One of the things she said when she looked at my tongue, and I didn't really understand what she meant by this, she said, you have too much yin. And that was when I was eating a lot of sugar and a lot of candy. Yeah. And I was totally programmed and all that kind of stuff. So I think there's that. But also, salt comes from deep within the earth.
Yeah.
Right? And it has a lot of minerals in it if it's the right kind of salt. And also, there's been wars over salt. There has not been wars over sugar. I mean, there is war. Like, they're at war with us by planting sugar and, you know, feeding us sugar everywhere. But there's never been people who be like, we don't have enough sugar. We want more sugar. You know, like, it has, like, there's been wars over salt. And they're constantly trying to say that, like, people should eat a low-sodium diet. Remember, they tried to pass a law in New York that, like, you couldn't have more than a certain amount of salt in food in restaurants. And that would kill the gourmet food industry. I don't know why you'd want to do that in New York. They're constantly trying to reduce, tell people that eating salt is bad. But these same people are not saying sugar is bad. So they're trying to raise the, I think salt also can hold information, but I think it holds ancient information. I don't think it's programmable. I think it holds information from like the, it's like a store of like tree rings, right? Like a store of historical data, but not just having information applied from outside to it.
Right.
There's some people that have, a bad reaction to salt, and I would say that generally, which salt are you eating? And also, if you have other problems in your diet, then that might make salt in some way exacerbate them. And if you've got those things under control, I actually eat kind of a lot of salt. I'm a salty kind of person.
I have no problem with that.
Dogs love to lick me because my skin is so salty.
A lot of animals go to salt licks. You know, they do instinctively go to salt licks. They wouldn't. Anyway. So yeah, so I think it's worth juxtaposing those two. Well,
also, one other thing I wanted to say real fast is that my friend Anne had like the one who died recently. She has a line of supplements, and one of her supplements that I take to deal with sugar cravings or any kind of cravings that can work for dairy cravings or gluten or anything like that is full of minerals. Full of like kind of ancient minerals that we're not getting in our food and stuff anymore. And it immediately makes you stop craving that stuff. Like when I first went on her diet and I was coming off of being like a total sugar junkie, that was like my saving thing. So if minerals are the answer to stop craving sugar, it would explain in some ways, this is interesting. We have almost no minerals left in our soil and all they're pushing at us is sugar. So it's like, I think, you know, the right kinds of mineral supplements, whether it be something like a, you know, a capsule kind of supplement, or even there's things like Cliff High told us about something called shilajit, that is like ancient minerals from deep under the Himalayan mountains kind of things. There's a bunch of other things out there right now, even some of this stuff with carbon 60 and whatever. These are all minerals from like deep within the earth. Wait a second, maybe deep within the earth is where we're actually from, right? So like maybe like those minerals are really important to us, and we're here in a foreign place where we don't have those minerals and we're eating sugar instead.
Right.
You know what I mean?
I mean, and what I just said when I said whenever I would get hiccups, I would put a tablespoon of salt under my tongue. The antidote to sugar might be salt.
Right.
Right?
Yeah.
And the other thing is this beautiful construct that you built based on this story that Randy put up that threw us all into,
And
I'm going to talk to you about that.
Okay.
Yes. The only thing I might quibble with is that I don't think we built the AI construct. I think that's where the AI construct, we encountered. Everything else you said
is
totally plausible and so totally logical and coherent that I hope that you just make a paragraph out of it or a page out of it so that you've got it sort of put it down so that the rest of us who are looking, who are researching
this kind
of stuff, and we can say, oh, and by the way, this bit, this little piece of beautiful thinking, courtesy of Emily Moyer, really knits a lot of stuff together for us. I mean, we're all, us researchers are always looking for people who can connect these dots and make it coherent for us.
Yeah.
So that we can make it, help make it coherent for the people who are also listening to us. This is all very, very, and see, we are so close, Emily. We are so close, and we're getting closer every day. We're getting closer every freaking day.
Yeah.
So, what else, hon? Because I don't think I have anything else to add to this particular part of the conversation. We'll be back.
The other thing I want to just say real fast, because it came up last night in the conversation with a friend. We were talking about a little bit, we were talking about like the role of psychedelics in this. And if anybody who's ever eaten mushrooms, psychedelic mushrooms, and you'd think, okay, like if that's fungus, you don't want to do that. But sometimes when you eat the thing the system is based on, like you kind of take a high dose of it, you see the system. And if you, anybody who's ever taken mushrooms, you understand, you get this complete sense of like understanding of the world that is different than what you had before, that seems right. And then there is some kind of technology there. Like there is some kind of like, it seems more like an organic technology than the way we're presented with technology currently. But, you know, that would make sense if we're dealing with like a really old system, right? Like it was a much more, you know, and there's a lot of things about biology that is technological, right? Look at things like, have you ever looked at like some of the things in the deep bottom of the ocean? They have bioluminescence. So there was a time when there was a further connection between technology and biology, and then things became just technological. And now they're trying to merge them again, but in a way that the technology is in control of the biology as opposed to the biology being in control of technology. So I think sometimes when you, and the same could be said for something like ayahuasca, right? Which is comes from the vines and stuff of the earth. You know, I don't have an opinion on whether these things are good or bad. I think a lot of these things, it depends on your, you know, it depends on how you see them and how you use the experience. But both of these things might be giving you a high dose, a taste of the system, and you see the system, and that's why you come back feeling like you have an understanding of where you are in the world, because you actually just experienced a high dose of the system, as opposed to this sort of, for a lot of people, non-awareness of it at all, or the low awareness of it that we walk around in all the time.
Absolutely good point. I'm always curious and I don't want to say suspicious. That's not what I mean, but kind of, you know, mushrooms, period. You know what I mean? That kind of, that may be the only natural fungus, that lichens, things like that.
Mushrooms, they're delicious. But it's kind of like something like truffles, like it's scary how delicious that is, right? The process for getting truffles, the way they have those truffle hounds that go and they dig up under the roots of trees to find them. And
they're fans. Yeah, they take pigs in France, right?
Yeah, it's truffle hounds. Yeah.
Well? Oh, okay. They know they call them truffle hounds. Anyway, okay, so yes. As you're getting these downloads, because I promise you, once people see this one as well, they're going to want the next one, because this is important, and people know it's important. Yeah. So, Emily, we will have a next one, I promise. I promise everybody out there, there will be a next one, okay? And I'm glad that she got a chance to get it on tape, because it's really important to get these things on tape. Especially, I know, when things are flooding through you, and it's like riding on a fire hose, you know, that's going, and the associations are so fast and so fast and so fast. And then if you don't take the time to write down the associations, just because you need to be able to retrace the trail for people. Here, because of this, and this is this and this. And that's how people, you know, can follow your trail of breadcrumbs.
I get a lot of this sort of stuff when I'm out on my run, and like I always, so I can't write it down then, and then I come home and immediately I have to get ready for work, and then I go to work, and then I come home and I'm tired. Hopefully sometime in the near future, I'll be able to create some more time for myself so I can really work on recording all these thoughts I have and then looking deeper into them. I'm realizing from just the way the path life is taking me on that I'm going to have to increase my scientific knowledge of nutrition and the body. And so I'm already actively engaged in doing that, which is, you know, taking up some time as well, but I think it's important. So I'm doing that. And I just also wanted to say, you know, like, I know some of this flow of thought here isn't completely linear right now and in some ways not completely clear. And I'm aware of that, but I just want to have the conversation started. And I look forward to thoughts and insights from you guys. I got some great ones from the last one. I would particularly be interested to hear from if there's any naturopathic doctors or nutritionists or you know, more alternative kinds of healing modality people out there that hear this, getting your thoughts and insights on them, whether you agree with me or not. Like, I'm totally open for criticism as long as it's respectful, intellectual, and honest, which is totally different than trolling. And, you know, it creates for the conversation. And I don't think I'm right about everything, but I think we're onto something. And I think the way that not just myself, but a number of people in our community right now are starting to think about things, like, I think that, like, this is something we can work with. These are the kinds of things that aren't going to lead us to that cul-de-sac you talked about. Not that
right. No, no, I don't think so either. And I want to say to you that you do a really, really good job of, you do a really good job of delivering these things in a coherent fashion. You finish your sentences, you know, you make the connection to the next thing. When a lot of times when people are getting downloads like this, they don't finish their sentences because they're pushed to the next thing. So you're doing good. You're doing great. I'm excited. That's good stuff. Okay.
Thank you.
So, okay. So then I'm going to say till next time when Emily's ready to give us some more stuff, and I can't wait because she's definitely onto something here. Okay, Em.
All right.
So let's say till next time. All right. Bye, everybody. Okay. I stopped.